Hannah. I am an instructor at Southern Wisconsin Center. Today we're going to talk about asepsis and preventing infection. So the learning objectives we're going over today are going to be reviewing key terms, signs and symptoms of infection, the chain of infection, hand washing, the types of precautions, personal protective equipment, and then bloodborne pathogen standards and common diseases. So some key terms, we have antimicrobials, which are agents that destroy, resist, or prevent the development of pathogens. Asepsis, which is the absence of bacteria, viruses, and other microorganisms. Bloodborne pathogens are microorganisms that are found in the human blood that can cause infection and disease. The bloodborne pathogen standard is a federal law requiring healthcare facilities to protect employees from bloodborne health hazards. Infection prevention is a set of methods used to prevent and control the spread of disease. Healthcare-associated infections are infections acquired while at a medical facility while you are receiving care. Microorganisms are a living thing or organism that is so small it can only be viewed under a microscope. Pathogens are microorganisms that are capable of causing infection and disease. And then personal protective equipment is equipment that helps protect employees from serious workplace injuries or illnesses resulting from contact with workplace hazards. So we're going to review some signs and symptoms of infection. Does anybody have any ideas of what that might be? Jamie?
Fever.
Fever, very good. So a couple other things that are signs and symptoms of infection could be redness, warmth, drainage, fever like you had mentioned, tenderness, odor, chills, headache, change in vital signs, nausea, vomiting, mental confusion, and diarrhea. So there's a couple different types of infection. We have local infections, which are just going to be specific to a location on the body. And then we have systemic, which is when that infection has spread from this one location into the bloodstream and now affects the whole body. And then HAIs, which are healthcare-associated infections, are those infections that are acquired within a healthcare setting during the delivery of medical care. So say you come to the hospital, you have your hip replaced, and then after surgery you have a surgical incision infection with MRSA. That would be considered an HAI. Which will lead us into our MDROs, which are multi-drug resistant organisms. Are microorganisms that are mostly bacteria that are resistant to one or more antimicrobial agents that are commonly used for treatment. So a couple examples we have here are methicillin resistant Staphylococcus aureus, which is MRSA, so that's resistant to the methicillin antibiotic. Vancomycin resistant Enterococcus, which is the VRE, which is resistant to vancomycin. And then carbapenem resistant Enterobacteriaceae, or CRE, which is resistant to that carbapenem antibiotic. So the next thing we have here is what's called the chain of infection. The chain of infection is going to have six links, and anytime you break one of those links, you're going to stop that chain of infection or that mode of transmission for that infection to survive. So the importance here is having asepsis, which is that absence of the bacteria, microorganisms, or viruses. So looking here, we have link one, which is that causative organism. So that's going to be that pathogen, microorganism, or bacteria. The second link we have is that reservoir host. So that's going to be that individual. It could be plant, animal, soil, that's going to carry that bacteria. And then we move on to the portal of exit. So that's where that bacteria is going to leave that host to reinfect another host. So we're going to move on to the fourth link, which is that transmission method. So that's how that's traveling or getting to that new host. And then we have our fifth link, which is that portal of entry, which is similar to the portal of exit, where it can be transmitted through any body opening. So eyes, ears, mouth, breaks in the skin. And then we're going to come to our susceptible host, which is that last link. So that's going to be that person, plant, soil, anything that's a good host. So anything with any comorbidities or illnesses, any elderly population, or nutrition, fatigue, medication, or stress can all be good factors into making a host susceptible. So that's going to mostly affect our elderly population. So how do we break the cycle? The best way to break the cycle is by hand washing. It's the single most important step. A couple other tips are going to be coughing or sneezing into your elbow if a tissue is not available. Never sharing personal items between patients, like razors, toothbrushes, hair brushes, even electric razors. And then disinfecting equipment between rooms, such as thermometers, stethoscopes, blood pressure cuffs, all those things need to be sanitized. And then not using equipment from the floor, so any drop linens or call lights need to be disinfected. So we're gonna come here, we're gonna watch a hand washing story, which is just a short video clip, and then we'll demonstrate proper hand washing with you. Okay, so now I think you guys all have a good grasp on signs and symptoms of infection, as well as proper hand washing. So we're gonna move on to the types of precaution that we have. So the first is gonna be standard or universal precaution. That's where you're gonna treat any blood, body fluids, non-intact skin, and mucous membranes as if it were infected. So it must be used with every patient, and that's just meaning you're gonna wear gloves when you do cares with patients. The next type of precaution we have is contact precaution, and that's gonna be used when a resident may spread an infection by direct contact with another person or object. So a couple examples could be pink eye or C. diff. And with that, you're gonna wanna wear gowns and gloves. The next type of precaution we have is airborne. So that's going to prevent the spread of infection of the pathogens that travel through the air after being expelled. Pathogens can remain in the air and are carried by moisture, dust, or air currents. So a good example of that would be tuberculosis. With tuberculosis, the proper equipment that you're going to need are gowns, gloves, and a special mask called an N95 respirator. The last precaution that we have is droplet. So that's going to be used for diseases that are spread by droplets in the air, followed when the disease-causing microorganism does not remain in the air. So examples of that would be influenza and pneumonia. For droplet precaution, you're going to want to wear a gown, gloves, and a mask. So that'll lead me into talking about personal protective equipment. I've mentioned with each type of precaution the equipment you're going to wear. So that's used to help protect us from serious workplace injuries or illnesses. Resulting from contact with workplace hazards. So those hazards would be your patients. So what do you need to know about your PPE? So you need to know what type of infection the patient has and how it's transmitted so you can properly be equipped to deal with that patient and their illness. So outside of each room, there should be a sign posted letting you know the type of precaution they're on, and the equipment should all be there right outside the door so you can have that available to you. If you're not sure, ask. It's never wrong to ask if you're unsure. So this next slide here is going to describe the donning and doffing. So that's going to be putting on and taking off your PPE. So we're going to take a break here. I'm going to go over different PPEs, taking on and taking off. And then I'm also going to hand out a little precaution game. So it's going to give you scenarios to go over, and you're going to break up into small groups, and we're going to talk about the type of precaution as well as what you need as far as PPE. Okay, so good job, you guys. I have confidence that you know the knowledge about PPE and what to wear and when you need to wear it. So we're going to move on to talking about bloodborne pathogen standards. So what that is a standard that requires healthcare facilities to protect their employees from any bloodborne health hazards. So bloodborne pathogens are microorganisms found in human blood that can cause infection and disease. So who mandates the standards? It's going to be a federal agency called OSHA, or the Occupational Safety and Health Administration. So they're going to make and enforce rules to protect the workers, conduct inspections and update safety standards, and then provides training to the employers and employees if exposures do occur. So for an exposure, every facility will have an exposure control plan that outlines specific work practices to prevent exposure and what to do when exposure does occur. So modes of exposure could be from a needle stick, mucous membrane contact, cuts from an object containing potentially infectious body fluids, and that could include human bites, and then having non-intact skin, and that also doesn't rule out acne. So bloodborne diseases, there are two major types, HIV and hepatitis. HIV, or human immunodeficiency virus, is the virus that can cause AIDS. It weakens the immune system so it can't effectively fight infections, so it's an opportunistic infection. So it's transmitted by blood, infected needles, mother to fetus, and sexually transmitted diseases. The other major bloodborne disease is hepatitis. So that's an inflammation of the liver caused by certain viruses and other factors such as alcohol abuse, some medications, and trauma. There are several different types of viruses that can cause hepatitis. There's A, B, C, D, and E. The common types are A, B, and C. Hepatitis A and E are spread by the fecal-oral route, so that's by food or water that's been contaminated by stool from an infected person. Hepatitis B, C, and D are all blood-borne diseases. So reviewing our learning objectives, we've discussed some key terms, reviewed signs and symptoms of infection and how to break the chain of infection, demonstrated proper hand washing, demonstrated proper PPE and types of precautions, and then discussed bloodborne pathogens and standards with common diseases. So I will hand out a quiz for you guys just to see that you understand the knowledge that I talked about with you guys today.